Thank you very much. Yeah, so today I want to discuss the story what I've been telling in the last three lectures for spherical functions. And in some sense, the key thing I want to, the birth of a dynamical A matrix, harmonic, classical harmonic analysis of the group G we had last time. So I started some preparations last time. So let me just set up the stage again. We have a semisimple algebra with Cartan sub algebra. We have the corresponding simply connected group G and its Cartan subgroup. I fixed a involution on G, Chevalier involution, which was compatible to the Cartan subalgebra. This is minus identity. And so I fixed the root vectors E alpha such that this additional condition that E alpha was sent to minus E of minus alpha. And so the fixed point subalgebra with respect to this involution is then spanned by what I denoted by the Y alphas, which are just the E alpha minus E of minus alpha. Okay, and this is a Lie subalgebra, which is just a reductive Lie algebra. In most of the cases, it is semi-simple unless you are in type C. Then it is, say, GLN. Actually, this viewing it actually as the fixed point subalgebra of the Chevalier involution actually allows you to think of it also as an Onsager algebra, if you like. So if you are more into physics, then you think, then you probably know that the Onsager, classical Onsager algebra can be described as the fixed point Lie subalgebra of a finite SL2 under the Chevalier involution. This is kind of the a finite classical analog of the Onsager algebra, if you like, and it has also a kind of Dohling-Grading type of presentation. Okay, so this is like an Onsager algebra. No, it is, this is reductive or semi-simple. So it gives a kind of a different presentation of just standard semi-simple and reductive Lie algebras as a non-Onsager algebra. All right, and so then, so K is then the corresponding Lie subgroup of Lie algebra. Okay, and we fixed two representations, finite dimensional representations of K, and we defined the space of spherical functions on G. They are representative functions with values in VL tensor VR dual, such that it satisfies transformation with respect to left-right action of the subgroup K according to the representation, tensor product of the representation over here. So this is the space of spherical functions, and it is spanned by the elementary ones, and they take the form this, where phi m is just an irreducible representation of G. And phi L is a K intertwiner from from M to VL. And phi R is a K intertwiner from VR to M. Okay?
GK is a symmetric pair.
Yes, yeah, that's right. Okay, so then radial part computation. So we are just going to play exactly the same game as last time. So we are just going to think about the spherical functions as functions on the torus by just restricting. And again, it determines now this spherical function again uniquely by some analog of the Cartan decomposition of your Lie group. So you will have the restriction map. That's this. Now again in just Laurent polynomials on A, tensor product with VL tensor VR dual. So in the case of trace functions, you get the zero weight condition on the spin space. That is gone because we are actually in the real split case. You are working with the Chevalier involution. It lands in a little bit smaller space. So it is in the subspace of invariant vectors for a finite group, M, which is essentially the centralizer of H, of this Cartan subgroup in K, which, because it is again split, just a finite group. But it does not play such an important role for this talk. So now we want to do the same thing over here. You just, as earlier, so this is all very classical. This is just Harishchandra. Harishchandra's theory on spherical functions. So you have the action of the center by bi-invariant differential operators on it. And you want to push it through to an action by differential operators. And that is now going to be a little bit different from the earlier story, essentially because K is not closed under conjugation by elements from the Cartan subgroup. So if you take, let's first look what happens pointwise. So if you take an element in the regular part of H, so this is the elements in H such that H alpha is not equal to 1 for all roots, then you have a vector space decomposition that your Lie algebra is decomposing as, well, it's convenient to work with the adjoint action of H inverse. Doesn't matter, of course, acting on K. So the image of K under the adjoint action of H inverse, H and K itself. This is a kind of an infinitesimal analog of the fact that G is K H K. And why is this so? So that is a little computation. So if you compute this, so I'm just taking a typical element over here, right? These are the basis elements. So I just take the corresponding twisted element in the subspace or in the sub-algebra, and I subtract y alpha from it after modifying it by h of minus alpha. Just computing what it is h minus alpha, h to the power minus alpha, e alpha, minus h to the power alpha, e minus alpha. You see what happens is that this term drops out, and what you're left with is h minus 2 alpha minus 1 times e alpha. So you can reconstruct your root vectors, right? H is regular, so this is not going to be equal to 1. Maybe I should be a little bit more, it's a little bit more regular than that, maybe. But, okay, no, so this should be enough, I think. And so you see, you can reconstruct your root vector in terms of elements in here and in here. And so that means that the right-hand side is equal to G. It might not be a direct sum, but then just counting dimensions, it's clear that it is a direct sum. Okay? What we need to do is to make this into a, no, not yet. So just Poincaré Birkovich, we have just an vector space isomorphism, vector space isomorphism by multiplication. Okay? And so this is kind of funny because that means that if you just take an arbitrary element in the universal enveloping algebra, it has some kind of natural decomposition, or it has a decomposition, kind of a Cartan decomposition, a Cartan factorization, where say on the left you have something in the twisted universal enveloping algebra of K, and on the right hand side you have something in the universal enveloping algebra of K, and in the middle you just have something in the Cartan sub. And this is for each age. And what is it? So if you just pursue this, you get, for instance, a factorization of your Casimir. So I invite you to just check this. It's not hard. It's just a computation actually using this expression of the root vector in terms of the y alpha. This is a big formula, but all right, here it is. And if you remember, I had some similar kind of factorization, age-dependent factorization of the Casimir in terms of Felder's R matrix. So this is a kind of an analog of that decomposition now in the setting of spherical functions. And you see here already also appearing that if you start computing the radial component of the action of the Casimir, it will be, I will write down the formula, it will be the Laplacian plus some first order term which you can gauge away, and then times some kind of quadratic or some potential in terms of sine hyperbolic to the power minus 2 with some kind of factor valued action on your K representation. All right. But to do this radial component computation, you need to do a little bit better than just having this factorization for each H independently. You need to get some kind of uniform version of that. And that is the following theorem, again, due to Harishchandra. That is that for all X in the universal enveloping algebra, is the unique element taking values in. So it's a fourfold tensor product. So the first one is taking just rational function, is a rational function on the Cartan subgroup. The second is in the universal enveloping algebra of K, third in the universal enveloping algebra of H, and the last one in the universal enveloping algebra of K again, such that for all regular elements, this is giving you this decomposition of your element X in the universal enveloping algebra isomorphism. So that means that for all H, just construct from my fourfold tensor product the corresponding element in the universal enveloping algebra of G according to this decomposition, you will get back your element X. And this is now for all regular H. So it's a kind of uniform version of this decomposition we wrote down before. So in particular, this holds true for the Casimir, or if you like, it also holds true for E alpha, right? I started with writing down a formula for E alpha along this decomposition. So if you just check what it is going to be, you see corresponding fourfold tensor product, you will see immediately that it is this, it's going to be this element. It consisted of two contributions, one for Y alpha itself, and one for the twisted Y alpha. This is for the twisted Y alpha, and this is for the Y alpha. So unfortunately, I wiped out the formula for E alpha if you decompose it along this decomposition, but if you compare, you immediately see this is what it is. All right, so now you can form a differential operator on H using this theorem. Define for X in U of G, I just take my X, I just find my expression as a fourfold tensor product, so I'm just factorizing it along this infinitesimal Cartan decomposition in a uniform way. And I'm just going to form from that differential operator coefficient pi I, the action of this xi on vl, action of the antipode applied to ci on vr dual. And then I have my Cartan contribution yi, and that I just let it act by left invariant differential operator on H. So this is a differential operator H with coefficients rational in H and taking values in the endomorphism space of VL tensor VR dual. And then the theorem is due to Harishchandra. This is what you wanted to do, namely that if you act by X on your spherical function as a left invariant differential operator and you restrict it to the maximal torus, then it is the same as acting by this differential operator immediately on the restriction of your spherical function to the torus. For all F for functions in U of G, left invariant differential operator on F and restricted to H is the same as acting by this differential operator on the restriction of the spherical function. And secondly, the corresponding linear map X to LX tall L tall this differential operator restricts algebra map from the center of the universal enveloping algebra to this algebra of differential operators. And both are not hard by the construction. So the construction, you immediately see that this is the construction such that this will hold true. And then the second part will be the consequence that a consequence of the fact that actually these this property is essentially determining your differential operator, right? So of course you can now apply this to the Casimir. You get the Laplacian plus first order contribution, which you can gauge away by some generalization of the Weyl denominator. And then you get a typical Kalogeromoser contribution factor valued with the action factor K representations. And so you can gauge, so again, you can gauge away this guy, and that will slightly modify the potential. It will actually be the same potential where this is going to be having, in addition, a linear term added to it. And then you immediately recognize that it is well, kind of a spin Kalogeromoser system, where now in the spin space, you are not acting by elements from the Lie algebra T, but you are acting in a representation of K. In particular, if you apply this, for instance, for SL2 already, or maybe better just for the symplectic Lie algebra, and you will have a one parameter family of one dimensional representations of that, because the K, the corresponding fixed point subalgebra, is reductive if on a one dimensional center. Then you can let these two act by arbitrary scalars. And so you will get then a BC type of a Kalogeromoser system with two free parameters. So it recovers, in some sense, the Heckmann-Obdon theory for BC with two continuous parameters in this way.
I don't understand the product is over what?
Plus or minus one. So it's just sine. So epsilon is sitting in the set, in the two set.
So epsilon, you're using epsilon to be.
Yeah, I run out of letters. Huh?
It's worse.
Oh, it's worse, right, yes.
Epsilon was perfect.
Yeah, yeah, I think so too.
Yeah.
So the fact that I'm talking about the real split case actually has the advantage that the reduced root system is the same as the root system of G. So the root system is unchanged. So it will just be the root system of your original semi-simple Lie algebra G. You can also do it in the non-split case, and then you will go to the reduced root system, and then it might change. No. So to get BC, you have to start with BC. For G to be the symplectic Lie algebra, then you get BC. If you start with SLN, then you will keep on hitting on a type of Kalogeromoser.
With the product of the sine, you said it would be a hyperbolic sine type, but you'll get a cosine T in the...
Yes. Okay. Yeah, that's typically for BC, right? You get, if you look at the BC systems, then you have... Okay, so and so this whole story tells you also the higher Hamiltonians of this system, and it tells you that elementary spherical functions will be just simultaneous eigenfunctions of these guys. Okay, so we can just continue that part of the story, and that relates it also to Heckmann-Obdon polynomials in special cases where you just act by one-dimensional representation. Final step is the endpoint spherical functions give rise to the birth of the K-matrix. So I'll try to set it up completely as we did for trace functions. So I start off with a graph.
I'm just trying to understand, this is no longer just the spin Kalogeromoser. You've got two, a left and a right representation. So it's some kind of tensorial generalization of the
It is a specific case where the spin space is the twofold tension product of 2K representation. Right.
Yeah. But that's left hand.
Yes. Yeah. But of course, you can make one trivial and the other non-trivial, and you get spin spaces only parameterized by 1K representation. So you have choices, flexibility, what to do.
Yeah,
so you have various ways to reduce it to maybe more standard situations. Right, so the graph, well, I'll just give it a super label B to distinguish it from the case for trace functions. B stands for boundary, so it's somehow related to boundary conditions. So N, capital N will be larger or equal than one. So N is equal to one will be the case of spherical functions we have just discussed. And the graph is now given as follows. One, N plus one. So I just distinguish the two outer vertices. But this graph, so for trace functions, we had just a cyclic graph, so just a Coxeter graph of affine type A. You can think of this as almost the Coxeter graph of type C, affine C type Coxeter graph. And this should be read as just this one in the case that n is equal to one. Okay, and so I think of, so I'm making those red because if you think about the gauge group action, I just want the gauge group action to be distorted at the endpoint. So I don't want the full group G as a gauge group action on the outer vertices, but only my subgroup K corresponding to the Onsager algebra. The situation, let's say in the Ballack, it's just G, but at the outer spaces, it is K. Okay. And so then you have again this the graph connections being the product group of G for all its edges. So the edges just get completely the color G. So this is just n copies of G. And then you have the restricted gauge group.
If the node 1 and n plus 1 are limited to k, don't you have only n minus 1 copy of g?
Yes, but so this is labeling edges, and are n edges.
Oh, okay.
So now it comes.
Okay.
So this is k cross g n minus 1 cross
okay.
So this is now acting on G, G connections in the way I discussed before. And so concretely, if you just give the formula, again, there are too many letters. I need to use the use of H for group elements in G is a little bit awkward, I realize, but what can one do, right? So the action of H on G then is just K1, G1, H2 inverse, H2, G2, H3 inverse, and then it ends with Hn, Gn, K, n plus 1 inverse. So at the end, it's not the full left and right regular action of the group G, but only of K. So now you can define endpoint spherical functions. Okay, so for that I have these. I want to be really careful now with indices. Okay, so I have two representations, finite dimensional representations again on the endpoints of my graph of the group K, and I have just finite dimensional representations of the group G for my inner vertices. And this is defined as taking just the representative functions on the n copies of the group, taking the tensor product of all these representations in the order of the graph. So VL as first, then I have my n plus one tensor products of representations of G. So then I have VR dual. This is now a representation of my gauge group by this action. This is, of course, a representation of the gauge group. And so I'm taking invariance with respect to the gauge group. Welcome. so for capital N equal to 1, it's just going to, we return back to our space of spherical functions. Right? So this is empty then. And so now we can just proceed exactly as we did for trace functions and follow exactly the same program and make similar remarks. So first of all, the n-fold tensor product of the center is acting on this space of point spherical functions, again by coordinate wise, g by invariant differential operator. We denoted that like this last time. So j is just the coordinate parameter and x is the element. Okay, so that's one remark. Second remark is that you have elementary endpoint spherical functions, right? So these are the subset of the endpoint spherical functions where you want the matrix coefficients to be in an irreducible representation of this n copies of the group G. And they are the space of such endpoint spherical functions that are is exactly the simultaneous eigenspace. The action of these coordinate G by invariant differential operators with eigenvalues just being the central characters of your irreducible representations pi 1 up to pi n, which we denoted in the previous lecture, C1 up to Cn. Okay. And they are spanned by the following guys, the following things. So the representation pi, so that's the irreducible representation. I will denote its representation space by mi. Then you pick k intertwiners here for these endpoints, which are k linear from m 1 to v 1. This is 1. At the other endpoint of your graph, you take a intertwiner, k intertwiner from v n plus 1 to mn. Okay. And then for in the middle, you take just the g intertwiners as we did before. So phi I, these are just g intertwiners from mi to mi minus 1, tensor si. And then the spanning elements following functions. So you take your left intertwiner phi 1, then acting by g 1, then phi 2, acting by g2, and acting by gn, and then you have your right k intertwining. So in a picture, it's better to see it in a picture, so you can just make a colored picture again of this. So phi 1 plus 1 over here, you'll have your middle intertwiners or vertex operators. And now you just also put in the action of g1, of G2 over here. Okay, and then you have all these spin spaces sticking out. So if, let's say in the graphical representation, you could write it like this. So you have G1 over here, that is your K representation. And then you have N minus 1. I don't know whether this is going to fit. N minus 1 G representations as spin contributions. And then finally, V n plus 1. And you see I just changed the orientation here in order to remember that that is the dual representation of the, this one?
The preceding one.
Thank you. Yes. These indices are painful. Now, fusion. Start with these endpoint spherical functions. Then you can again just immediately find a linear isomorphism just to one point spherical function. And what it does, it sends f to f where you just evaluate in the first n minus 1 coordinates by 1. And over here, so you have here this tensor product of a K representation and N minus one representations of G. And you just view it as a K representation via the diagonal action. So you have this special K representation. That is how, in some sense, these endpoint spherical functions arise. You look at spherical functions where one of these K representations is of the particular form of K representation tensor product with some G representations, then acting by the diagonal action of K. It's similar as what we did for trace functions. We said, okay, let's replace this spin space by a tensor product of G representation. And then you have your restriction polynomials with values in what is going to be, say, this kind of spin space. And so over here, you have your action by the n-fold tensor product of the center by these coordinate-wise G bi-invariant differential operators. And so you can push it through this map, and it produces over here a commuting family of differential operators on G. Sorry, not commuting, if X, yes, it is commuting, sorry. It's a family differential operators. And they are not going to be all right invariant or left invariant differential operators, as was the case for trace functions. Only if you are just acting on the last coordinate, it will be immediately just an action by left invariant differential operators. But for the other coordinates, it will be an action by right invariant differential operators. But that's okay. So it is. The reason is when you act by a coordinate which is not n, then you are acting somewhere in the middle, and you want to push it to an action. You should write it over here. And you want to push it to an action here on this last variable. But if you are here, so what we did in the trace case is we just moved it through the trace until it's on the right of Gn, but you cannot do that anymore. So the only thing you can do is you can just push it actually to the right through the intertwiners until you get an action over an element of the universal enveloping algebra on the left of Gn, so it will be here. Then you do this theorem by Harishchandra to push it through this restriction map. And you get a family here, commuting family of differential operators. What I did, I formulated the theorem for left invariant differential operators, how you compute the radial component. You can, of course, do it also for right invariant differential operators. So you get this family of differential operators taking values in the endomorphism algebra of just this whole spin space. Wait. it is double row. Okay, so let's formulate the theorem. So now we have again competing Hamiltonians. So right, so you have natural Hamiltonians, and you want to compare them. We denote by J, and just the difference of the neighboring Hamiltonians scaled by a half. So let me just formulate a theorem which gives a complete expression, a full expression of this differential operator, which will again be a first order differential operator. And it will be an analog of these KCB operators, which I wrote down yesterday for the endpoint trace functions. So they are kind of boundary. So for that, to formulate what it is, I need a little bit of notation. So if it's just some function, this is something you can explain from, say, the symmetric space perspective, but I'm just putting it here as a kind of awkward definition. I make a new function, so I'm shrinking the torus in some sense, or blowing it up. Shrinking. So I define a new function on the torus where its value at h is just the value of s at h squared. So what it does is, if you have an expression in terms of these characters of h, xi alpha, the alpha will be replaced by 2 alpha. So it is in some sense replacing the root system by twice, rescaling the root system by 2. And so we had Felder's R matrix. Just write it down again. So we already recovered this guy from trace functions. So this is a minus. E of minus over there. And now I'm going to fold this guy. So that is this kind of doubling. So I'll write R plus minus to be the symmetrization or anti-symmetrization of R in the first vector with respect to the Chevalier envelope. In plus or minus R plus R where I apply the Chevalier involution on the first vector. This is the notation for theta tensor one. So you see if you apply the Chevalier involution, then here the sign will change and you will get plus this vector where this is replaced to actually the root vector at alpha. And so you see that actually this guy is going to be a symmetric tensor. Right, and then I define what will be playing the role of a dynamical K matrix. So I just take my theta twisted R matrix and I multiply it out. This is just multiplication. So this is a quadratic element. And finally, recall that we had this kind of unfortunate factor in the usual KCB operator. First order Cartan element actually doesn't, it's just can be gauged away at the end of the day. So then the theorem is a result of mine with Rashtikin will appear this year, is that these boundary KCB operators, so this runs from one to n, is given by the following first order differential operator. So you have your differential operator, first order differential operator, where you have it's a kind of an Euler operator where you act with the elements xi in the j presentation space of the spin space. I'm sorry, this should really be 2 up to n. And then you have, so the structure now is the same as before, as for trace function. So you have now a sum from LS2 to J minus 1, where now you have this folded R matrix acting, let me be careful, so sigma L tensor, sigma J. Then you have something which is only acting on the J spin space. And finally, you have contributions to the right. So now I'm just making the same mistake. So I want to keep the same notation. And then some is J plus 1 up to N of sigma J tensor sigma N. And this is only, this is if both boundary representations, trivial representations. So if they are not the trivial representations, you can also give a similar formula, and there will be another contribution here to this term, where actually it is also acting on this outer spin K representations. So these are the boundary KCB operators. You see that what is happening here, if you compare it with the usual KCB operators, there are two things which are happening. One thing is that these R matrices which appear in the KCB operators are getting folded with respect to the involution. And secondly, what is happening is that there's a non-trivial additional term appearing, acting at the J spin space. And so if you, for instance, check what it means for these operators to commute, which is automatic by the construction we have been doing, you will see that actually these folded R matrices satisfy a kind of a mixed dynamical Young-Baxter equations. And then this K hat is going to be a kind of a solution of the corresponding reflection equations. But this really plays the role of a solution to of a K matrix. And so you get simultaneous eigenfunctions automatically from the elementary and point spherical functions, etc. So you can just conclude the same way as we did for endpoint trace functions. So I wanted to explain how this folding actually can be understood. So I gave you the way to prove this theorem, because I just explained essentially how you can go from these coordinate G Bayer-Van differential operators to differential operators on these endpoint spherical functions. And you can just sit and compute for 2 days and you will get it. Maybe a little bit more than today. But there's also a very nice way to see how this folding goes, because in some sense what you're doing in that, just of course erase the picture. Here is you just implement your Casimir between two intertwiners, and you can just factorize your Casimir in an appropriate way and then propagate to the left and to the right. And every time you propagate, you get just an usual R matrix contribution in spin space. But then you hit the boundary. And you hit the boundary, and the effect of hitting the boundary is that your R matrix is getting twisted by your Chevrier involution. Okay, so that is giving this twisted R matrix. And then you get this twisted R matrix at the boundary. And then you, the only thing you can do is you can decide to return to your original spot. And then the very nice thing is that as soon as you return to your original spot, it somehow completely starts acting on the spin space. And that is producing this K matrix at the end of the day. So it's just created by this bouncing and returning. Then it just creates your K matrix in the spin space. Another very nice computation method for another time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. For questions, comments?
How explicitly,
how
explicitly can you actually compute these endpoint spherical functions? Can you express them in terms of, something like the idea of the product?
So they are, so in the setting I've been discussing now, which is the compact setting, they are generalizations of Heckman-Ogden polynomials. So in case that you take, say, the ordinary spherical function. So if you take just your K representations to be one-dimensional, for instance, you return to special classes of Heckman-Ogden polynomials. If you take another, so what is interesting is you can take other classes of representations for your auxiliary spaces. So for the spaces attached to your edges. So I just took finite dimensional representations. If you take their admissible representations of the real split form of G, like principal series representations, then these elementary spherical functions will appear as Eisenstein. If you take for this class of this representation category, the highest weight representations of the Lie algebra, you can do it somehow infinitesimally and think about the corresponding functions as first just living in the positive Weyl chamber of your real torus. Real split torus, then you get a class of eigenfunctions which are, in first instance, formal power series solutions to your differential operators. You can then show that since they satisfy these differential operators, that they are actually analytic functions. And these are then solutions which have the special property that if you go deep into your positive Weyl chamber, they will just return to wave functions. It will just be essentially an exponential function. So they are, in physics, you would call them maybe asymptotically free solutions or asymptotically free eigenfunctions. And from representation theoretic point of view, these are then elementary spherical functions which can also be expressed in terms of Harishchandra series. It highly depends on what kind of category of representations you put on these auxiliary spaces, but you get very interesting different classes. Yes, we did. So the computation is a bit more involved. but that also is going to appear. So it's on the archive already. The thing is that then this phenomenon happens, there will be this more serious phenomena that you will These will not be operators acting on this full tensor product representation anymore, just like for trace functions. It will live in some subspace of invariance of this space. And so you take the subspace with respect to M, which is the centralizer of H and K. And that messes up a little bit some of the story, but not much. So you can just get also explicit formulas for this. But for instance, if you then compute what it means for these building blocks, so in this case, these building blocks really satisfy kind of standard Young-Baxter type of equations, or reflection equations. But in that case, it starts to mix up. You get some kind of glued versions of Young-Baxter reflection equations, which you cannot somehow pull apart anymore because of this subgroup.
Questions. Thank you very much for the whole.